But the problem is the players on both sides of the game, they both love him.
Who's that, Winston?
Yes.
Yep.
He's amazing.
What do you compare him to, Vinny?
I guess.
Yeah, Vinny's a good one.
Would you want him?
Early Vinny.
Do you want to see activity?
Would you want Winston on your team?
Would you want
him as your starting quarterback?
Yes. Yes. He's better than Deshaun Watson. Much
probably
better.
Not at Cleveland.
I'm saying, like, would you want to sign him to be your starting quarterback?
I would say probably 12 to 15 teams would say yes.
Yes.
You know, the thing about him is he's gonna get all the fan bases excited. You're gonna have fun with him on the field. He's not conservative, he doesn't give a shit, he just throws the ball everywhere. And it's remember the old AFL?
Oh yeah.
He reminds me of that.
He's
and they called Brett Favre the gunslinger.
Oh, not with this guy.
He's gonna get a
good. By the way, Greg, have you started recording?
Yes, I have.
Oh, okay. I just wanted to see if it was something I did on my screen or where all of a sudden the recording popped up in the middle with no warning.
No, I absolutely did. I'm getting sick of you guys talking about all sorts of good stuff when we haven't started the show yet. So I said, you know what? I'm just starting this. I'm recording. I'm not even mentioning it.
It's a good idea.
Anyway,
here we are. Mark isn't here yet, but he will be. Mark will be here soon.
You just wonder how many great scenes were left on the cutting room floor of the Godfather.
Yeah, well, that too.
That's true. Yeah. Sometimes the outtakes are better than the shows.
Yeah.
So the rankings video came out yesterday. And, well, the rankings actually came out, not the video, but the rankings came out, the bracket. So we got championship week. I find it interesting. Look, I'm not surprised that Alabama's in. Who's surprised? I mean, you know, it's Alabama, Ole Miss, Miami, and you know who they were going to take. Yeah. So, but I just really believe South Carolina is the team that's gotten screwed the most. That's just my opinion. You know, they're the hottest team out of the bunch. And I don't I don't understand why the commissioner said yesterday that there's nothing that any of the teams who aren't playing can do. There's nothing they can do or there's no variable that can be done while they're not playing. Why is a Clemson win in winning an ACC championship not affecting South Carolina in a good way? They just beat them on their home floor and then they win the ACC championship. You're telling me that's not going to affect where South Carolina might be? That just shows you right now. They don't care. It's Alabama and Alabama's going to get in no matter what happens.
Yeah, I would consider South Carolina's win over Clemson on the road is much more deserving of an Alabama 21-point loss at Oklahoma.
Hell yes. But, you know, we thought the election was over. Politics is still going on.
Always.
It's disgusting. It really is.
I tell this to all my – every year I say the same thing. My favorite sport's college football until the end of the regular season.
Yeah.
And once the politics begin, I'm out of it. It's terrible. At least we have 12 teams now, though. So that's going to make things a lot more – interesting, especially, and I got to look at it from a gambler's point of view too. Of course, that's what the show is all about. All right, you want to bring Alabama in, you want to bring Georgia in, even if they lose, fine, go ahead and do that. That means when they play their opponents, they're going to be favored, and the numbers are going to be inflated, and I'm going to take advantage of it.
Well, not only that, and I still say we're not that far away. Maybe within 5 years, we're going to have those four super conferences with between 16 and 20 teams each. Let's say we have 20 teams, okay? The top 16 will get into the conference playoffs because you'll have four divisions of four teams each, maybe a couple of extra teams, five teams, let's say. And they're going to have quarterfinals with eight teams, semifinals with four teams, and then the finals with two teams. So that's three games to decide it. And you'll have – that'll basically be a true playoff because if you have 80 teams, you're basically eliminating basically the group of fives or maybe many of the group of fives. I think a lot of it really depends on Notre Dame joining a conference, whether it be the ACC where they're affiliated in basketball or more regionally the Big Ten. I think once Notre Dame finally gives in, that may be what's holding up those four super conferences where we can have as close to a true playoff like we have in NCAA basketball in college football.
Well, Notre Dame is not going to give in until or unless they get screwed at least a couple of times. They're just not going to.
Or the money is worth it. or the money. Yeah, they're
making so much money with their television deal, and they haven't been screwed by the committee yet. But a couple of years where you get screwed, and if you were in the conference, then maybe you'd make then. But at this point,
what we have to realize is that Notre Dame today is not the Notre Dame of 50 years ago. Well, Notre Dame was the team 50 years ago. All those people are gone now who were Notre Dame fans and alumni and all that. Notre Dame is just another very good football program. However, I guess the 70 and 80-year-olds in charge of the TV networks still consider Notre Dame a rich enough property, a grossing enough property to continue to give them their own contract at the expense of Notre Dame having to join a conference. It was big news when Notre Dame basically became affiliated with the ACC for a number of years, especially in college basketball. So the next logical thing is, and again, it may be depending upon the networks, and they still see tremendous value in Notre Dame. And, maybe I'm missing something there, but it's a lot different demographics today than it was in the 1960s, 70s, and 80s.
My only beef is going to be if SMU gets left out, because that means you've basically told a conference finalist you shouldn't have made this. You shouldn't have made the effort, you dummies. I mean, that really is it.
Who was their one loss to?
SMU? I mean,
yeah. BYU.
BYU. Okay, yeah.
How do you think BYU's feeling? So wait a second. We lost two games. One game we went and beat SMU on their home floor, and nobody talks about us at all. We're just insignificant. Mm-hmm. So, the whole thing. Look, SMU loses, they're not going to make it. Because it's basically going to be between SMU and Alabama, and they're not knocking Alabama out. They're just not going to do it.
Their brand is that big, definitely. Speaking of two lost teams, we got a team down here in South Florida that is hurting big time. I know the wounds were self-inflicted, guys, for our Hurricanes last week. And by the way, while I'm on the topic, congratulations to Mark for that 4-star best bet on Syracuse last week. Didn't even need the points. Our service was on the over in the game, so we hit both sides of that one. A double teamer, if you will, Syracuse and the over in that game against our Hurricanes. But if you want to talk about frustrated two-loss teams that have lost to the Alabama brand, Miami's definitely one of those. I mean, look, they demolished Florida, a team that beat Ole Miss. The Canes demolished USF. A team that took Alabama into the fourth quarter in Tuscaloosa. Their two road losses, guys, are a combined 9 points against two pretty good teams, too. Number 22, Syracuse, and a 7-5 Georgia Tech team that just took Georgia to 8 overtimes. Instead, the committee, they docked Miami more spots for a road loss to a top 25 team in the country than it did for Ohio State losing to a 7-5 Michigan team. So, again, there you have it. There's another frustrated two-loss team, our Hurricanes down here.
And Miami, because of their defense, would be a very entertaining team to have in the college football playoff.
The only good thing is this year we have 8 less teams that can complain because they went from 4 to 12. That's about the only positive.
The other thing, too, to consider this, and I know haven't heard anybody ask the question, but I mean, I'm serious. What if Georgia loses and that's 3 losses?
Yeah.
They're 7 already. I mean, why can't they get knocked out? Why can't Miami beat out Georgia?
Not only that, that would be 2 losses to Texas.
Yeah.
It's not like losing 2 different teams.
But I honestly would favor Georgia over Alabama just because at least Georgia reached the conference championship game. So
yeah, Alabama did beat Georgia head to head.
Yeah, and that is a dichotomy there for sure.
I would like to see rescheduling. Now the Big Ten, at least they play 9 conference games. With all this expansion going on, I'd like to see teams in conferences play at least 10 conference games. Maybe have 1 non-conference game against a traditional out of a conference rival that you might have, and maybe have 1 money-making game for an FBS team, for an FCS team. But the other games, all make them conference games. You shouldn't have Nebraska playing, UL Lafayette or teams like that in their non-conference schedule. Give them 1 gimme game. Give them like a Nebraska-Oklahoma game or something like that every year. make the conference games much more, and it would eliminate a lot of those questions about, because most, if you play that extra game or two, then you're talking about conference teams that have three or four losses at the top, not just zero, one, or two.
Two funny things to consider out of this. A brilliant, under, it hasn't really been under the radar because it's heavily criticized, this SEC move of scheduling like Sisters of the Poor. Like somebody did it with Louisiana Tech, Louisiana Monroe. We had an FCS opponent.
In November.
In November, because all these teams are exhausted, and that's when you're most vulnerable or looking ahead to something else. So that's been a low-key SEC class move. And then the other thing of now everybody getting having direct access to one another for everybody else to see. The SMU AD was getting criticized by the Ole Miss AD. Lane Kiffin was going at it with Miami backers. It was fantastic last night.
I love part of that where one of, I forget who it was, who was making maybe a, I think it may have been the South Carolina guy who was making thing, and counter argument that was made against South Carolina. Well, you look at Alabama. Yeah, they had that loss, but they won their other games, including that win over Mercer, which is to your point, Tony. And I've mentioned it for at least 10 years that the SEC knew exactly what it was doing by scheduling those games. Because let's say Oklahoma's playing Texas, let's say in November or something, and both are teams that are in the top 10 at that time. One of them's going to lose and fall down. Alabama, meanwhile, is playing Mercer. They win by 45 points. They get an opportunity to move up if they need to without playing anybody. So I think that the NCAA should have a rule that says no FCS games after September 30th.
Absolutely.
Yep.
All right. What about Ryan Day? Everybody kind of believes that Ryan Day, unless he wins a national championship, is going to probably be gone anyway. So I don't know if Ryan Day leaves on his own, on his own accord, but that's the way it looks. Do you agree?
I would doubt that he would leave on his own accord, because there's so much money that he'd be leaving on the table unless they worked out some sort of buyout settlement. And Ohio State does have some very well-heeled alumni that they could afford a buyout if they wanted to. But I heard someone today who's got some good opinions in the industry who said that Ryan Day is most likely safe even if they don't win the national championship. But there could be some issues if they fail to get past their opening game in the college football playoff. I could see that because, if ever there was a year that they were going to beat Michigan and beat Michigan handily, this was the perfect setup for them. Michigan rebuilding, having a poor season, getting them at home, and the seniors having never won a game against Michigan because the 2020 game was canceled because of COVID. So the seniors the upperclassmen on this team had lost three straight games and, wanted to avoid being probably the first class in a half a century to never beat Michigan while they were, assuming they were 4-year or 5-year students.
And so is this on Chip Kelly then? Because the hilarious thing is Michigan went ahead and fired their OC QB coach after the win. Obviously they didn't have a quarterback all season. So is this on Chip Kelly? They scored, they had the exact same offensive production as a bad Michigan offense.
Well, that was Ryan Day's.
Yeah.
You have to blame Ryan Day, because Ryan Day basically brought Chip Kelly in, and what they want now, again, however you feel about Chip Kelly, the fact is that Ryan Day felt that in order to beat Michigan, he had to play Michigan football, that he had to start to run the football, play power football. Maybe it's not a coincidence that last 22 times that these two teams have met, whoever rushes for more yards wins the game. So that was the intent. That's why, even though Henderson was one of the best backs in college football, they also brought in Judkins. They wanted to play power football. And the problem was,
you didn't need to do that this year against this Michigan team, though. That's the thing.
And they also brought in Howard, who's not McCord. See, McCord would have kept that passing game going with those receivers, and that would have kept them that, sort of like that traditional Ohio State offense. But they didn't want McCord. They wanted Howard. They wanted a multi-dimensional quarterback that could run the ball. You can run with the run. So that's the whole idea. That was the game plan. Now, they did have the injuries on the offensive line that we talked about a couple of weeks ago. That hurt them. Going up against two of the best defensive tackles in the country that Michigan had. So they got dominated at the offensive line and on the line of scrimmage. And that's what cost them. And look at the game plan. How many times did they run the football? Even though they were getting stopped, they kept running or attempting to run the football, and they couldn't do it. So again, if you're a fan or an analyst, do you think Ryan Day should lose his job?
I'd give him one more year, but I would say that by saying that you can convince me otherwise if you give me one or two guys that you can get right now that would be an upgrade.
And what about what do you think about I know we didn't talk last year when you made the decision, and it's hindsight, of course, bringing this up, but I mean,
Cignetti.
What do you think? No, I'm just saying about the quarterback position. What do you think about the decision to let McCord go?
Doesn't look very good right now. Game.
You know, he had the bad game when they lost last year, but then again, Michigan beat everybody last year. So yeah,
McCord had a really good. McCord had a really good season with a much, much less talented Syracuse team supporting him.
Yeah.
And I think the pressure kind of got to McCord. Maybe he was not prepared for it. He's obviously a lot younger. Less pressure environment at Cuse, and he flourished. He threw some picks midseason, but I mean, the arm talent is unquestionable.
And historically, Ohio State has not been an NFL successful quarterback producing factory. There are a very limited number of Ohio State quarterbacks who've made it into the pros going back, 30, 40 years.
Yep. Stroud's the first one to really break that trend.
Right. Yeah.
Mark is not going to join us today. He is still behind.
It's a full buy.
He's still behind on the newsletter. So he just wanted to let me know. And I have his complimentary play here, which I'll get into in a little bit. I'll hold that off for everybody. But before we move on to the NFL, we have one big segment to go in college football, and that is our game of the week. A couple of teams we have not talked about yet. And that's the two Big Ten teams, Penn State and Oregon. Oregon's still a defeated team. Penn State, this is another opportunity for James Franklin in a big game situation to try to prove something. I've said before, I have been doing the Penn State post-game shows all season long. So I know more about Penn State this year than I've ever known for a long time. And one thing that I have noticed, and I'm being honest here, is that I'm with everybody else on James Franklin. So that has not changed. But this season, this team is his best team. And he doesn't have the best players he's had, but it's his best team. They keep responding week in and week out, game in and game out. You know, when something happened in the past, it would snowball in a negative way. That's not happening to them this year. But still, they had their one big test, and they failed. Here's another big test. So if they can win this game, they are now, in my mind, I think if they win this game, not just because they're playing number one, I think if they would have just beaten a top five team, I'd feel this way, but they happen to be number one, so it's going to be an easy remark. I think if they win this game, I think they turn into, in my opinion, maybe the favorites. Not that I'd say it out loud, because that would all of a sudden put all the pressure on Penn State, and that's not a spot they want to be in. But they're talented enough to do that. The question is, can they do it? So what do you think about the game, Tony?
I mean, it's a winnable game. I want to know real quick, because I'm taking you off topic here, but since you do the Penn State postgame, why did he do that to Mike Loxley?
Yeah, that's my question too.
He does not like him. I mean, they go back a long way.
Is it
they
go him back a long or way. Or the fact that he got passed over for the Maryland job a couple of times?
They go back a long way. There's a lot of bad blood there. Okay. So, that was not a surprise. Matter of fact, I like Penn State because of that. You know,
My nickname for Franklin is the merciless bully.
Yeah, that was crazy. Yeah, that was a situation.
Look what he did to Kent State. In fact, I wrote up this game this week. They outgained Kent State by 652 yards in a 56-0 win. 652 yards. I mean, well, now Kent State was 0-12 on the season, but you knew they were there to begin with. I mean, you should be playing your third and fourth stringers if you're up by that margin. If you're a fourth string, if you're Kent State, I think should be reasonably competitive against a fourth string unit on Penn State.
Yeah. Well,
maybe not the second or third.
Just keep it in mind for next year, everybody. Yeah. Keep it in mind. Lock it down. No matter how big that spread is next year, take Penn State against Maryland because he can't stand the guy and he's going to run it up. And that's something that you want when you, when you're giving up that many points. So, yeah. What do you think about the game in general, though, guys? Because, again, it's just, I actually thought the spread was going to be close to 6 or 7, even though I like Penn State in the game. I did not expect them to get this much respect. Now, I don't know if that's, again, because they are getting a lot of respect, or after what Oregon had, what happened a couple weeks ago at Wisconsin, and keep in mind they're a little bit banged up. But
they may have been looking at, even though it was 2 weeks, they may have been looking ahead to the Washington game last week. In fact, I was going to mention that Oregon is now 24-2 since the start of last season. Their two losses last year were both 3-point losses to the ultimate national runner-up, quarterfinalist, whatever it was, Washington. So, they lost to Michigan. Yeah. That this is a very strong Oregon team. They outgained 7 of their 12 opponents by 200 yards or more. And they averaged they had a better yards per play differential in all 12 games this year. This has been a very dominant and consistent team. The one, and they also dealt, I mean, look, other than the game to Michigan, they dealt otherwise unbeaten Ohio State, their only loss, and they dealt otherwise unbeaten Boise State, their only loss. This has been a very, very solid team all year. I also was surprised that the line was as low as it is, but I happen to like Oregon in this game, though the stats overall can certainly make a case for Penn State. But then again, Greg, you mentioned this is a big game, and it's especially big game for Oregon considering what happened last year when they also were in pretty much control. If they had won that Pac-12 championship game against Washington, they would have been in the Final Four.
Yep.
Notwithstanding Florida State.
I like Drew Aller and his ability to make plays, but nobody, to me, makes more plays that I trust right now, especially with Miami's QB out, than Dylan Gabriel. Especially since he has Johnson back. So it's good to see Tess Johnson back. It makes a world of difference. So my place is going to be on the over here with no weather in Indy. So
I was also going to mention, by the way, how the artificial surface in Indianapolis and the indoors helps Oregon speed.
Yeah.
What's the total? Victor?
The total opened at 50.5. It's down to 49.5.
Yeah, 40.
It's come down about a point. Both teams are 5-7 over under on the season. 5 overs, 7 unders. You got a couple of 30-point plus game offenses, 2 very good defenses, both allowing less than 17 points per game on the season. The point spread also surprises me, like you guys as well. I was anticipating about a 6-point spread in the game, particularly given Penn State's modus operandi is just a plain flat out underdogs. I mean, they've been horrific as underdogs since the 2018 season now. 1-12 ATS as underdogs of 14 or less points. Penn State, just flat out. So, yeah, they can run up a score against the bad teams, and they can James Franklin can inform his alumni to bet the farm when they're laying points against the bad teams.
Or Maryland.
But as an underdog, this team just does not compete against the better teams in college football. The favorite in the Big Ten championship has gone a perfect 3-0 straight up in ATS in the last 3 years. The last 5 Big Ten championship games have averaged 44.6. I don't have a dog in the race as far as over-under goes. I can see potentially more points, especially because of the fact that the overs in indoor venues, dome stadiums, like in Indianapolis, have gone 37-28, about 57% over the total going all the way back to 2005. And, of course, for references, the conferences this week that will be playing indoors are the Big Ten Conference, like this one, the Big 12, the MAC, and the SEC.
Yeah, Penn State's dropped 9 straight games straight up as a dog, which is not good.
Go ahead. I was going to mention one other thing here quickly. I'm going to throw 2 numbers out at you. Penn State, 21.7. Oregon, 19.8. That adds up to 41.5. That's not the average points these teams score or the average points these teams allow. It's the average margin of victory and these two teams combined 23 wins in 24 games this year. That's astounding, those numbers, because a lot of them are against pretty decent teams as well. So they, and of course, we know what Penn State does when they can blow out teams. So at that total of 50, given that it's indoors and what you mentioned, Victor, that does seem suspiciously low.
Keep in mind, too, that the Big Ten championship game is similar to some other championship games where there are the conferences that have niched the divisions. And we know the Big Ten had a major advantage from one to another. So it was always the Ohio State, Penn State, Michigan side dominated the Wisconsin, Iowa side. Yeah. And so, yeah, so I wouldn't really worry too much. I'm always going to follow trends like that, but I wouldn't worry about it in this circumstance specifically, but we'll find out. This is a good way to keep that going or not, because those days are over. The other thing, too, is Oregon, really, if you look at it, they haven't exactly played a very tough schedule. I mean, really. I mean, yes, they've got the Ohio State Boise State game, which everybody points out. But other than that, their other big wins, big, were Illinois, Michigan, and Washington. They've only beaten 5 bowl teams. That's it. So they have not had a gauntlet of a schedule. And that's something to consider. Penn State's played, I believe, 7 bowl teams, I believe. Which is about
I take a look at their non-conference games, and Penn State played West Virginia, Bowling Green, and Kent State. Oregon did play an FCS team, had a great season, and is probably better than Kent State in Idaho. They're a 9-3 team in the FCS level, and they also played in non-conference games. Boise State, and actually traditional rival early in the season, but no longer a conference member, Oregon State.
Yeah, I'm looking at this more for the, to tell you the truth, because I don't think it matters much in this matchup, even though we're talking about it. I think it does matter when we're going to be next week previewing the playoffs. I think that's where it's going to matter more. This will be a 6th team. So this will give us a good gauge of where Oregon stands going into the playoffs, how they play against Penn State. Yeah. But we'll keep that in mind next week. But yeah, I agree. It's not like Penn State's had a juggernaut of a schedule compared to Oregon's. But yeah, I think we're all in agreement that the line is a little low. Does that mean as I go around for picks that I don't know if you guys have them? I know it really comes down to Andy and since Vic's out, Andy and Tony. So, Tony, do you have a pick in this game?
The over, but one thing. So, this is basically for obviously the conference championship, but it's for a bye and a home game, correct?
That's right.
Because there's no way that both of them.
Penn State might still be able to get. I think Penn State will still get a home game. I think they'll find a way to still get a home game, because if you look at the brackets right now, all you have to do to get a home game is be like the 8th seed.
Yeah.
So even Ohio State's getting a home game.
Yeah.
I mean, Penn State though does have more to play for, so I would feel uncomfortable laying points in that situation, but I would not go against Oregon. They've seemingly won when they needed to, made plays when they've had to, so the over would be my call.
Yeah, keep in mind too that when they lost or when they struggled against Wisconsin, there was no Tez Johnson, as you mentioned, Tony. And keep in mind, too, they had a very early bye. So they were really coming to the point where, guys were getting banged up and missing games, and they just needed a break. And that Wisconsin game, they were just very fortunate to not play a real good football team at that point.
They still outgained them, I think, by 100-something yards, a little over 100 yards.
So who do you like, Andy?
I'm going to point out something interesting. It's probably been pointed out elsewhere, but it's interesting. These four Power Four conference games all involve teams that are in their first year in their new conferences. Oregon in the Big Ten, Texas in the SEC, Arizona State in the Big 12, and SMU in the ACC. So it's interesting. Do you want to do – and by the way, all four are favored this week too, albeit a couple of short lines with SMU and Arizona State. Well, actually, all of them are really short lines. Do you want to do a four-team money line parlay on the new kids on the block all succeeding, or do you want to pay a four-team money line parlay on, hey, not so fast, rookie. We're still know about this conference, and we know a few things that come down to our championship game. So just a little bit interesting that it's very unique that, A, that all four of these conference games involve a newcomer, and, B, that all of those newcomers are favored. I happen to like Oregon in the game. I also agree with the over. I think the site is going to help the Ducks, and they're playing again with a little chip on their shoulder from what happened last year. Even, you know, I mean, 2-3 point losses. You know, you're not going to get in with 2-3 point losses in a 4-team playoff. But I still think over the past 2 years, the body of work that Oregon has displayed has been very impressive. And again, you pointed out the numbers for Penn State in a in the role of an underdog, which obviously means they're going up against a team that arguably is considered better than them, or at least depending upon the site, no worse than them. At some point, that's going to end. And, you know, even though I like Oregon in this spot and got a lot of reasons for him, I can see Penn State winning the game, but my money's on Oregon.
Yeah, Oregon has won 8 straight, covering 7 of their last 8 as a single-digit favorite, including 4-0 straight up ATS in their last 4.
How, so by the way, go. How far back does that go, being single-digit favorites? Is that a couple of years?
I was just doing it myself, and I believe it was like 2 or 3 years.
Yeah.
So yeah, because I know they weren't very often a single-digit favorite. So I just started to look at it myself, and I think we only go back no earlier. I would say 2021, the latest.
Yeah, makes sense.
Okay, so that's college football. Now, NFL. And we are going to, before we zero in on our game of the week, which is going to be Atlanta and Minnesota.
News in that game, by the way, about the quarterback.
Okay.
I believe I heard that Penix is going to be taking over a starter, I believe. I think I heard that about an hour ago.
Okay. Well, make sure you get that as a fact.
Well, that would be news to me because they said that there was no interest in that.
Well, we'll double check that because if it happened, it had to happen. Like you said, Andy, like within a very short period of time, because I just finished talking with and interviewing Kevin Knight, who's with a really cool sounding website that follows the Falcons by the name of thefalcoholic.com. And Kevin does a great job. And we did that as part of the Our Lads Football Network interview. So I went over with him trying to find out everything about Kirk Cousins, so forth. You could find that interview, and I'll put a link to it to the Our Lads website. Also, of course, want to remind everybody that this show, the entire full-length show, you are watching here on the new ProLine TV YouTube channel. We still have segments of the show on Playbook Experts YouTube channel, so you're not missing anything over there except the full-length video. So there are some segments that you can only get here on ProLine TV. So remember that to subscribe, link, and share here at ProLine TV. That is definitely something you want to do because we're going to stay here even through college football season, NFL Super Bowl, March Madness, and more. Not going anywhere. Okay. So, yeah, that was the one thing I wanted to find out because everybody's wondering what happened to Kirk Cousins. It looks like he had a dead arm last week. And the fact is that, you know, he's had his ups and downs this year. But according to Kevin, I mean, it's really just been about the competition. And he felt the same way last week. If Kirk Cousins has to deal with pressure, if he can't step up in the pocket, he's toast. He does not have the arm strength anymore. Didn't matter if it was week one or last week. That's the bugaboo, is when he has to play really good defenses. And it's really just going to be up to the brass in Atlanta to decide what they want to do, because the schedule gets a lot easier after this. But there was no way, Jim, no way, that they were going to sit Kirk Cousins in this week's game, not against the Minnesota Vikings, with Kirk Cousins returning to Minnesota. If they're going to sit him, they're going to wait one more week before they make that decision, because that would really be a pretty douche thing to do, but they're not going to do it, or at least we don't think they're going to do it. Mute button, Jim. Jim will need to check his audio. You might want to come out and come back in and check your audio, Jim. So why doesn't someone else pick it up until we hear Jim?
Cousins is 0-3, 6 picks, 4 fumbles. From Raheem Morris did say they're not contemplating a change yet. But, I mean, it's him against Sam Darnold in Minnesota. So that basically is this his last chance. They're still first in the division. It'll be interesting to see whether they make a move if he plays poorly again.
The thing about Penix, I mean, this guy doesn't have any
any NFL experience, and this team they're going against, Minnesota's pretty damn good. They've done a lot of things right, offensively and defensively. But when you watch the tape of that game last week, it was obvious Cousins is not at NFL standards right now. There's something wrong. And it's
I think he's still covered up an injury, Jim. Yeah. Cousins.
I mean, we know about the Achilles, but there's got to be something in this arm.
Right, something in the right shoulder, Jim. Yes, you're right.
Yeah. He was throwing bubbles. I mean, like you would throw it to your child. That's how soft those passes were.
Well, like I said, they're not getting any better. So it's really just a matter of maybe they just don't feel that Penix is ready. We're not there in practice. We don't know what's going on. Maybe they just think, no, it's just not ready. We just can't put him in now. And if that's the case, and Kirk, I mean, you would have to think, look, as bad as Kirk looked last week, then you would. That's why I wonder if Minnesota game was not this week. If it was the Las Vegas game, if it was a week from Monday and it's the Las Vegas Monday night game, would it be like, all right, Penix is ready, but we just can't do him. We can't do him like this week against Minnesota. We just can't.
What happens?
Maybe the adrenaline will kick in against his former team.
What happens if he has a bad start to the game, throws two picks in the first half, and they're down 17-3 at halftime?
Probably see
good question.
It's possible.
Yeah.
Against that Minnesota defense.
Absolutely. So this is also going to be very interesting for Tampa Bay, guys, because Jim and I have talked about this on some of our other videos, which you can catch here at ProLine TV, where we went over Tampa Bay's best scenario of catching Atlanta. We talked about this a couple weeks ago, that these 2 weeks would be it. Last week when Atlanta played LA, and this week when they played Minnesota, and last week when Tampa Bay, Carolina, and Las Vegas this week. These 2 weeks, Tampa Bay needed to catch up and not only catch Atlanta, which they've done, but hopefully, in their sake, take a one-game lead.
Right, they have to because Atlanta's 2-0 against Tampa this year, right?
Yep. So that's why
they have to have a better record, definitely. Right.
So one more week, unless Atlanta wins and Tampa wins, and then Atlanta gets on a roll, and let's keep in mind this. Second to last game of the season, Atlanta plays Washington. And that is the other team that both NFC South teams are chasing if they don't win the division. So that would give them another shot. I don't know whether or not they can catch Washington without, say, Atlanta beating Minnesota. Keeping in mind, Tampa's schedule is a little hit or miss. But again, that's also an important point. What do you guys think about Tampa Bay's shot? Passing Atlanta, and whether you think it's actually going to happen.
I think a lot of it has to do with the quarterback play in Atlanta. I think Atlanta has the better overall roster than Tampa Bay. Maybe not defensively, but I think those both appear to be 500 teams. So, and clearly we're getting good quarterback play in Tampa, not so much right now in Atlanta. So I think the situation is a lot more dire for Atlanta. And if indeed, Cousins continues to struggle. And I think you're right. This is a huge game for Minnesota just to decide what happens, because you might be right as far as maybe making a switch against the Raiders. Right now, I would have to say Tampa's chances are better. Roster-wise, Atlanta has the edge, but rosters don't necessarily win games.
I've already bet Tampa to win this division. So, I mean, Baker Mayfield,
baby.
He's my champion in the clubhouse, because he's most valuable player level the way he's been playing. I mean, he doesn't have the team that some of these other guys do that are probably going to win the most valuable player, but he's doing a hell of a job down there. This is obviously, did they know something when they drafted Penix and everybody said, why are they doing that after paying all this money to Cousins? Did they know something or suspect something?
Well, Jim, let me ask you this though. Do you say it like that? Do you think it was basically because of the amount of money they spent? And I say that because nowadays, I think what we have to do is we have to reevaluate when teams bring in a quarterback, or if they have to sign a quarterback, they're pretty much hamstrung. They have to pay these guys $30, $40 million. There's nothing they can do about it. Look at Daniel Jones. Daniel Jones was not worth $40 million, but they felt like they had to do it just to give him one more healthy year to see if they got something from a high draft pick. So, yes.
definitely the market.
Yeah. So yeah. I wouldn't, if I'm an Atlanta fan, I'm not blaming the front office to pay Kirk Cousins $35-40 million. You have to do it.
Well, plus Cousins at the end of his career.
Injured player in New York. You've got Aaron Rodgers not playing well. You got this guy's hurt. He's older too. He's not playing well. You got Mac. You got Stafford, who's also in that age range, who has not had. I mean, he's had a couple of good games, more than maybe these other guys, but he's not playing great. I mean, the last two games at home, he's been a disaster. He might wake up this week because he's playing a team that's already celebrating about winning their division. So it's possible he can wake up and win that one.
Plus, the other thing is that
I think it was, by the way, it was a great move by Atlanta to see. I think they wanted, I look at it as maybe they wanted to draft Penix anyway. They knew that was what they were going to do. They knew no one else was going to get him that high. And he, and then they went out and signed Kirk Cousins. And then a few months later, they made the move, or a month or so later, and made the move for. So I think that's probably the way that they looked at it was, we're going to draft Penix, but let's go ahead and sign this guy. And it, because we don't want to throw him in there to the Wolves. We also want to see if we can get off to a good start for at least a year, maybe get good graces back. This is a division we can win. Everybody thought the Falcons were going to be the team to beat this year when the season began. So I look at it that way.
I was thinking that they must have felt, for whatever reasons, I'm not going to dispute what, you know, what they're thinking was, that Penix may have been the best quarterback they thought would be available, and they were looking towards the future, as Kirk Cousins, because of his age, is a short-term solution. They got Penix on a rookie contract that goes for, what, 4 or 5 years, whatever it is. He can sit there and learn for a year or two, be mentored sort of by Kirk Cousins, who, you know, seems to be not like an Aaron Rodgers as far as a you know, possibly preparing your successor. Nonetheless, I think that was all part of the plan, and may just mean that, and again, if they liked him, they may have felt that, well, we don't know how Cousins is going to recover from that injury, and will he be able for a full season, but maybe they saw something in him which says, you know what, if he sits for a few games, he might be ready to go in there as a rookie, having absorbed everything that we would have learned in the early part of the season. So I think, Greg, in a sense, you're absolutely right that it was part of a longer vision than just this year.
Yeah, they have these quarterback classes scouted out. They probably said this is the guy that we want out of these next three classes. And, you know, Cousins was viewed as a missing piece for a team that's set to win immediately, and Penix was the guy for the future. So I could see all of that. But now you get to the point where if Cousins continues to play poorly, Penix has looked like he's ready to play. So you could come to that decision. And now the question about Tampa Bay, keep Baker Mayfield healthy, he just comes off a game where he thought he popped his Achilles. So that's not good. And you barely beat the Panthers. You needed a last-second field goal, you know, march down the field 30 seconds just to tie it, and then a fumble to get the ball back in the OT. So, you know, very fortunate for Tampa, though a good sign that Mike Evans showed out, because he was looking a little shaky there upon his return, you know, 100-yard game last week against Carolina and that nice touchdown.
And speaking of the South.
Much line movement. I see absolutely no line movement on this game, Minnesota. It's been this line all day, no movement.
Five.
I think the report may have been that they're just considering it, but they're not making any decision as of yet. And you know, we'll have to take the head coach as at his word. And he says what most head coaches say before they make the change. We're not contemplating a change.
So it's still what, five?
Yeah, five and a half.
Okay. So the other thing too, as far as the South, you mentioned Carolina. And we talked about this last week, and it happened again this week. Great. I love to see – it's not like he's thrown 400 yards the last few weeks, but this is real good to see that Bryce Young is starting to play a lot better. And especially when he's not surrounded by a lot of talent still. It's still a very young team. They've got a bunch of injuries. But ever since the bye, things have worked out really well for them. It's a great sign. And they're not a pushover now. That's three straight games that the Panthers have played, especially the game against Kansas City now. Can't be looked at as, Chiefs, you know, they were just, they knew as soon as the Chiefs are the Chiefs, the way they've been playing all year. But still, you take the Chiefs down to the wire. You take the Tampa Bay Bucks down to the wire. So I look at it more as Carolina's been playing some really good football. I don't look at it as Tampa Bay, you know, isn't very good. And they're lucky to beat Carolina, even though when you're in a must-win situation, man, those are things that you just can't avoid to have. You know, those are the things you have to avoid getting yourself involved with, especially especially if he ever gets hurt, because that would not be good. That offensive line is bad. That is the big – now, they got defensive problems, but they've got to fix that offensive line at Tampa Bay, or else Baker Mayfield is not going to last there.
Absolutely.
Keep in mind with Atlanta, a highly regarded first-year coach taking over some talented players who weren't producing in the prior regime. So this kind of progress from mid to late season from a first-year coach is a good indication, and also not really a surprise if he is indeed a highly regarded coach.
All right. So as far as some other trends to throw in there, let's see. The Falcons 0-3 straight up ATS, scoring only 36 points in those last three games. Minnesota 5-0 straight up, which is 2-2-1 ATS last five. But here's the big one. Minnesota is just 1-7 against the spread in their last eight as a home favorite. So this has not been a good spot for them, a good role for them. Atlanta is definitely desperate with the three losses. Would you feel more comfortable with this line in this situation, Jim? If anybody out there wants to take Atlanta, would you roll the dice on the nearly 2-1 money line? Or would you just be way too nervous about Atlanta and you want to take every point you can get?
At this, after watching multiple times, I watch a lot of these tapes, especially for contenders and games that are including contenders. After watching what Atlanta looked like last week, there's no way I can bet on
the money line.
But I don't want to lay 5.5, 6 points with Minnesota.
Yeah.
This is one of those things where, and teaser expenses is, they become more expensive and it's not as valuable a bet anymore, no matter if you're doing the Wong bets or not. But I would have to bet Minnesota in a teaser if I'm going to play them. Because if you're going to shut down Atlanta, and they easily could shut down Atlanta if they can't put a quarterback out there that can play, it's probably Minnesota money line and under.
Okay. What's the total, Vic?
45.5, I believe, guys, right? Another aspect of the game that basically has not moved since Monday morning. It's just rock solid right there at 45.5. If you do like the under, now's the time to get in, because if it finishes on 45 or 44, you'd cash a winner. Still haven't decided which way I'm going to go in terms of the total. It's been a high-scoring series between these two in the last few meetings. I know that Atlanta is struggling on offense. Believe me, 13 points at home last week. As you guys mentioned, they haven't cracked 18 points or more in each of their last three games. But according to the database, that's a good time to play the over. And I got a – what do I got here? I got a 10-1 since 2015. When you got a 500 or better team on the road and they're an underdog and they've scored 17 or less in each of the last three, it's actually gone 10-1 to the over. This is also a weird situation in that next week in the NFL, we're back to two Monday Night Football games next week. I'm looking forward to that.
I didn't even know to see that.
Both of the teams in this game will be playing Monday Night games the following week. I forgot who the Falcons are playing. I believe the Vikings
Vegas.
Are playing the Bears.
Vegas and Atlanta.
You also got two powerful over situations when you got a road dog playing before a Monday road game. The over has been a good play. That's the Falcons. And if you got a home favorite before playing a Monday home game, that's the Vikings as well. So some of the database numbers suggest actually that the game might be a little higher scoring than people think. And a lot of people will not be playing it based on the Atlanta offensive struggles over the last month of play.
So how do you make the choice? I mean, you're the data that you have and the trends that you have on that, what do you do? You don't know who's going to play quarterback, and you don't know if Cousins, if he's in there, can he actually do anything but just hand the ball off?
Right. Is it a revenge game for Cousins? How do they? We'll say this. His best career numbers are in this stadium. So I do believe that he has his best game in a month this particular week. Again, in a stadium he's very familiar with in an indoor environment.
It brings up the question of who has the advantage. Does Atlanta have the advantage or with Cousins knowing what the Minnesota does on defense, although it's a different defensive coordinator this year? Or do the Vikings have the advantage because they know Cousins' tendencies, strengths, and weaknesses?
Right. That is the question.
This is a very hard this is a hard handicap in this game.
I will say one thing. Minnesota, again, is involved. I think six of their games, or maybe seven, have been one-score games again year, almost reverting back to 2 years ago. So, you know, if this line goes up to six and I decide to play the game, I would have to take the points with Atlanta. You know, it's hard to argue with Minnesota with what they've done without Kirk Cousins. I mean, obviously, he was gone for much of last year. But, I mean, this team is what's their record now? They are 10-2, one game behind Detroit, one game ahead, or half a game, I guess, now ahead of one game ahead of Green Bay. So Minnesota really can't be all that displeased that Kirk Cousins is no longer their quarterback. The fans may give him a positive reception, but if you're 10-2, everything you're doing is working out.
If everything was the same and the line was picked, what would you do?
I'd play Minnesota. Nice.
Yeah, not even a question.
By the way, that's the problem with the teaser is you're giving up the number zero, so it's basically a 5-point teaser to a certain extent. If it does go to six,
some of the teaser value, right? Yes, you are. Yeah.
Except a lot of these 5.5s are -115.
Yeah.
Well, if Kirk Cousins has one more game left in him this season, then this would be it.
This would be Yeah.
It's the revenge game. Their backs are against the wall. So I wouldn't blame anybody out there that wanted.
What was the situation? Did they not want him back, or did he decide I'm going to test the free agent market?
Well, they let him test the free agent market.
Yeah,
they said go ahead.
Coming off an injury.
But what's his revenge? You got a big paycheck.
Yeah. I mean,
I'm not going to be too mad.
So
about
thank
that.
You.
Yeah, they really shouldn't be.
He's not going to get booed here. This is a skull spot for me. I mean, we just saw the Vikings come through against Kyler Murray with two critical fourth quarter turnovers. So they're in a good spot on that end. I'd be concerned about Darnold turnovers or Aaron Jones. He's put the ball on the floor the last two games in key spots, but you know, hopefully catching that late game winning touchdown pass has him in the right frame of mind to come through here. But at this point you're expecting to see Cousins for at least a half. My pick in the capsules I wrote this week, pick a quarterback you most want to fade and take the over on their interceptions. This is Darnold and Cousins. 10 turnovers in the last three games.
I like that, Tony. In fact, that's the first thing I did bet in regards to this game is both quarterbacks to throw an interception.
Yeah.
The other thing to look at here is that Minnesota is 7-4-1 against the spread, so it's not like they haven't been making their backers money. And one thing, and I'm sure Jim can relate to this, you often want to go on a team when they are really out of favor, and there aren't very many teams that are out of favor right now as much as Atlanta. That's still certainly in first playoff position.
True.
Minnesota is also 0-5 against the spread as a home favorite of more than 4 off of back-to-back straight up. Wins.
All the trends say bet Atlanta, the quarterback.
Yeah. Right, it might be one of those Mark Lawrence hold your nose plays, but Minnesota really had no business winning that game last week. They got out yarded by over 140 yards against the Cardinals.
I know they just
that's a tricky.
A lot of people are saying the Cardinals this week. A lot of pro bettors that I talk to like the Cardinals for that very reason.
Yes.
Not only that, it's a revenge game from 2 weeks ago against Seattle, that 16-6 loss by the Cardinals.
Right.
And also, the Cardinals essentially control their destiny to a certain extent, especially if they get this win. Even if they don't cover the game, they already have a big home win, blowout win against the Rams at home, who they still have to play. And, of course, that road win, which is key, at San Francisco, and they also get to host them later in the season in a rematch. So this is really a very important game for the Cardinals. And, of course, if they do beat Seattle, and hopefully they do and cover, they would then negate any tiebreaker edges because they'd both be 1-1 in their series.
Well, I look at this as just as important for Seattle because Seattle's next two opponents are Green Bay and Minnesota. Oh, Arizona's next two opponents are New England and Carolina.
Yep.
So if Arizona wins this game, then Seattle is probably in big trouble. And so I look and this is another thing to keep in mind. You say revenge because they lost.
Yeah.
Well, Seattle's beaten them 6 straight times.
Yeah.
And
I think they won it. Didn't they win at the end of last season or 2 seasons ago? in a meaningless game, Seattle.
No, Seattle's playing good ball.
Yes, yes. And that it was a game that I don't, I would think it was a game that it was only meaningless. I think they found out at halftime or something like that. And they still won. I think I remember that because I remember something about the post game and yeah, it was something about it. I don't remember what it was, but.
Well, the reason why it's also, by the way, one reason it is also important for the Cardinals, they would then tie Seattle atop the division.
Well, that's what I'm saying. That's why Seattle would be tied. And then the schedule for the next 2 weeks all favors Arizona. So Seattle would be in a bad shape here if they lost. But not only have they lost six straight to Arizona, to Seattle, they're the favored. See, that's the thing that I always like taking advantage of. Wait a second. This team is now beating the other team six straight times. They just beat him 2 weeks ago, and that team's the favorite. So I always jump on those other teams. I'll say, until you beat me, sort of like what we talked about last year with Oregon and Washington, until if you've not only proven this over several years, but just a few weeks ago, I'm sorry. And who's playing better? Seattle obviously is playing better than Arizona is right now. By the way, Arizona 0-7 against the spread, their last seven, when they take on a division opponent with a winning record. So we'll keep that in mind as well as Seattle goes in on a three-game win streak. And do you know
Who did Seattle beat the last 2 weeks and who did Arizona lose to the last 2 weeks?
Well, do you know Seattle in their last three wins, the last 3 weeks, they've all been a dog.
Including at the Jets.
They were a dog to the Jets? I didn't realize
the
that.
The Jets are favored over everybody.
Yep.
Yeah, so, isn't that amazing?
Which doesn't make any sense. Except this week.
It's like betting the Bengals under. I mean, what, you just like to burn money?
It's just ridiculous. It's crazy. Jim's a big – I know what Jim thinks about the Chicago-San Francisco game. San Francisco is losing everybody. McCaffrey's now out. They've dropped three straight.
So is the backup running back, Mason.
Yeah.
Mason's out too.
But the Bears are 11-22-1 in their last 34 as road dogs. And they're 0-5 straight up as a true road dog this year. But they've just lost their last six straight, including the last three by a total of 7 points.
Does the new coach come in there?
Yeah.
Yep.
And especially very popular because he's helped Caleb Williams with the offense, Thomas Brown.
So we'll see how that goes. Tampa Bay, as we mentioned, has got that Vegas game. So that's big. Tomorrow night, huge game, Green Bay and Detroit. That line is only 3.5. But again, I think I've mentioned this several times, Detroit and Dan Campbell have these awesome stats. Dan Campbell is 8-0 against the spread all time versus 500 or greater division opponents. So that basically means when he's taking on a pretty good division opponent, he covers every time, including 2-0 this year. And he's 29-9-1 all time against the spread versus 500 or winning teams.
The concern I have there is last week's game against Chicago is not the fact that they sort of relaxed in the second half, but that they had all those difficulties in the first half, leaving 4 points on the board, settling for field goals rather than touchdowns. I expect a very focused effort out of the Lions this week because this is a huge game for them because they're only one game ahead of Minnesota. And if Minnesota wins this weekend and Detroit loses to Green Bay, which is quite possible, those teams would be tied, although they will meet, I think, the last game of the season. I think it's in Detroit because I think Detroit won the first game at Minnesota. At the same time, it's an important game for Green Bay if they still want to have off. Green Bay almost certainly will make the playoffs because of the mediocrity in the NFC West and the NFC South that you have to believe Green Bay is going to be at no worse the number three wild card and quite possibly it would be the number three because Philadelphia is going to win in the East and, well, maybe Washington in there. So it's a big game for Detroit, and I expect a better effort out of the Lions tomorrow. I also think we might see a high-scoring game. I think the total victor is pretty reasonable in this one for two teams that have the power to put up points quickly and in bunches.
Detroit, meanwhile, will host the Buffalo Bills next week. So that is going to be a matchup that a lot of people are going to say –
Super Bowl preview.
Is this a Super Bowl preview?
That might be another reason to look at you talked about Buffalo and what they have next week against what people think might be the best team in football, arguably, of course.
Look at them this week against
the Rams.
They're
playing the Rams after clinching the division for five straight years, traveling across the country to play the Rams, who are desperate, and then have next week they got to play Buffalo. This is a little bit of a little letdown here for Buffalo.
The only counterpoint to that is they still have an outside shot. If Kansas City were to lose, they have the tiebreaker edge for the number one seed.
Okay,
when you look at Kansas City, the problem they've had is each of the last few weeks, or for the whole year, actually, they take big leads in games and then give them up, and the games end up close, 30-27 against Carolina, last week against the Raiders, and now they're supposed to get Humphrey back at left tackle, which is the blind side of Mahomes and why he's getting hit all the time.
And so, Pacheco's back.
Yes, so you have some stuff going on here.
Well, either way, that just shows you that Buffalo, they have to continue to play as best they can, because it is a big difference for the Buffalo Bills to have to go to Kansas City in a playoff situation, which they don't want to be in. They've been down that road before. Pittsburgh is trying to get revenge on Cleveland. They just played them a couple of weeks ago. Cleveland coming off a short week, and they've got to go on the road, back-to-back games. So look, in this series, the home team is 11-1-1 straight up, 11-2 against the spread since 2018, only in the regular season. So keep that in mind. But the home team has really dominated this series. I think after what happened a couple of weeks ago, and with Cleveland already have beaten them, and yes, a little bit of a short week, of course, and all that stuff, I expect Pittsburgh to come out and
put up a really good effort.
What
about the total in that game, Victor, with Winston throwing the ball all over the place and then Russell Wilson coming out and scoring all those points against the Bengals?
400 plus
yards.
Know
the Bengals have no defense. I understand that.
It's a cool game because, look-ahead line was 40 and a half. And based on what happened on Monday night, when the smoke cleared, it jumped all the way up to 44 and a half.
Wow.
So it's gone up a full 4 points. Whoa. Since Monday morning, based on that. And you're absolutely right. This is 2 years in a row now where Cleveland has turned into this incredible over team in the second half of the season because of a major quarterback change. Last year, of course, it was Joe Flacco. This year, it's because of Deshaun Watson. And all of a sudden now, Cleveland is this fantastic. Jameis Winston is an over betters dream, because he's going to get you 6 points one way or the other, whether it's a pick six or if it's a passing touchdown. So you may have something there, Jim. Now, we lost some of the value. If we really liked the over, we would have bet it balls out before the Monday night game. But still at 44 and a half, you could still see some points down there at
40,
the Petra bottle.
At 40 was a gift, wasn't it?
Right.
Yes.
And then Sunday night football, the Chargers, as you mentioned, Jim, will take on the Kansas City Chiefs. And the Chargers have won 5 out of the last 6 straight up ATS, but they've dropped 4 straight as far as the spread is concerned in their last 4 since last year as a road dog. So
the Chargers have a couple offensive players out, and if I'm not mistaken, I can't remember their names at the moment. They got brain dead.
Well, their running back is out, Dobbins.
Dobbins is out, right?
And McConkey's very questionable.
The other one. There's
a good chance McConkey won't play, right?
What's it, McConkey?
Yeah, McConkey.
When Burrow goes after, passes the ball to him, he's over expectation on completions with that player, McConkey.
Herbert?
McConkey. Yeah. But Herbert's passing, yeah.
Right, I read those numbers, Jim. Absolutely. He's a different quarterback when he's thrown him.
Somebody else, his expectations in the 30s. So it goes from over 50 to that one player to under 40 with the other players on the team. This is not a prolific offense.
He was still a high draft pick, but it's wild. He's made the most impact out of any receiver in this class. And we've got Neighbors, and we've got Marvin Harrison Jr., but it's been Ladd McConkey.
Right, Rome Odunze.
Elite slot receiver, and he's gotten it done in the NFL, but very questionable. I think it sprains to his knee and his elbow. They might hold him out. And in that case, I touched on this game too already, not on the show, but I write Capstones for Sporting News. They give me games, and I kind of ghostwrite them. So, you know, what I like in this game is the Chargers team total. They just won a game specifically because of their defense. The Chiefs are going to blitz Herbert, and they've been winning games ugly. So I like the Chargers team total and have no interest laying points with Kansas City.
I was going to ask Victor what he thinks about the total for the game, because I think this is another under as well for the game.
I did bet this one at the look-ahead line of 44. We're in the neighborhood of 43 right now, and it makes sense. Tony, when you said the Chargers team total, was that the Chargers team total under that you liked?
Yeah, 19.5.
Right. Definitely with you with the difference and the injured players as well.
I think that's a good bet, Tony.
What I bet in regards to this game, in addition to the under, is that, and I haven't touched the point spread yet, but what I did do on Monday morning,
guys, I'm going to go bet that right now.
I threw some Chargers to win the AFC West division money in, and we're still getting 15-1 to 16-1 odds on the Chargers. And again, I just think it's a case where the Chiefs' luck at some point runs out, and instead of 11-1, they might be 14-3, 13-4, 12-5.
Yeah.
Their numbers as far as season-long DVOA are right in the middle, the Chiefs. More a playoff contender than a Super Bowl favorite. And, again, I just think there's tremendous value on a Charger team to potentially win a division.
I was going to ask you, Victor.
And you can still get 15-1 odds.
Yeah. Would you consider as well a money line play on the Chargers this week? Because if they lose, their chances at the division, you know, they lose a full game to and they would lose a tiebreaker to Celeste earlier. So maybe if you feel that nice about now, there's value, of course, as opposed to the feeling how comfortable that you're actually going to collect. But
right, and that is your choice. Playing a plus 170 money line. But rather than playing the plus 170 I would rather play LA at 16-1 odds to win the AFC West.
Well, I was going to say that if you make a play on the Chargers to win to win this game, you could at least cover whatever you may have played on the Chiefs on the Chargers to win the division. Even if they don't win the division, you could at least cover that bet if they happen to win this game. Because if they don't win this game, if they don't win this game, their chances of winning the division with what, 5 games left? Would be very four or five games left.
Significantly worse, right? Yeah.
So a money line in this game might be worth it.
Or Kansas City can win, and Victor could lose both bets.
Yeah.
Chiefs have beaten the Chargers 6 straight times, but the Chargers have actually won 3 of the last 6 at Arrowhead. Keeping that in mind, they seem to play the Chiefs a lot better on the road. And the Chiefs, as you guys have mentioned, are struggling against the spread. They're 0-6. Their last 6 ATS. Chargers 5-1, straight up ATS last 6. I did speak with my Chiefs insider, Charles Goldman, from A to Z Sports, and he said that right now the Chiefs are a team that is, as Jim alluded to with the DJ Humphreys deal, they're a team that's getting healthier. And he mentioned Pacheco. You got Pacheco back. You got Humphreys coming up. Marquise Brown is supposed to be back in the next week or two. So he believes he's going to pick things up right away. It's not going to be a month-long wait and see if whether or not he can really impact the offense. So you could have an offense by playoff time that'll have a healthy Marquise Brown with DeAndre Hopkins and Travis Kelce and Xavier Worthy and Isaiah Pacheco and DJ Humphreys at left tackle. And all of a sudden – the Chiefs are back.
Right, so the only one not coming back, and you've got Kareem Hunt activated. As you know, you can split carries with two guys. So, look, they're blessed in a way that the 49ers have been cursed, which is wild. Yeah.
Another thing to consider: last year it was the loss to the Raiders. They hadn't lost since until they lost to Buffalo. And, you know, here it is. They arguably could or should have lost to the Raiders the other day. And maybe they're doing what they did last year, gearing it up as the playoffs come. You know, they're not interested in covering point spreads. They're interested in winning games and being as healthy and not being as taxed as maybe going for some extra scores. Maybe this is the week we start seeing that Kansas City team that we saw at the end of last year after last year losing to the Raiders and this year getting a very close call with about 5 games.
If you're adding Humphreys and Pacheco in 1 week to this offense, and they are taking leads on people. I mean, they were up big on Raiders. They were up big on the Panthers.
You taking the first half Chiefs this week, Jim?
Pardon?
You taking the Chiefs first half this week?
You know what? The answer is if these injuries to the rate the Chargers are valid and those players are not playing, I will definitely be on the Chiefs.
The one thing I'm looking at here, if you go back to that week two game, the Chargers got off to a 10-0 lead. You know, this was Harbaugh's second game with the personnel and everything. And then they didn't score again. And I think it was a fourth quarter score that the Chiefs made to get the 17-10 win. So I have to believe, even with the injuries notwithstanding, Harbaugh is in a better position right now to know, A, how they were able to have success early, and B, why they didn't have success the rest of the game. Now, obviously, you have to have the talent. But I place a great deal of emphasis on coaching. And Harbaugh and Andy Reid are two of the coaches that I have the highest regards for. So I wouldn't be surprised if this one also comes down to a three-point game.
I am going to be talking to my Chargers insider next week on the Our Lads Football Network. And sometimes I'll be able to edit some of those interviews like we did last week here on ProLine TV, so you can check it out. Matter of fact, we're going to be doing that, especially whenever there's two teams playing each other and I get to interview both insiders. That's going to be kind of fun. We get Jim's perspective, Mark Lawrence's perspective, edit that in with my interview with both insiders, making one really cool video that we'll post here on ProLine TV. So we're going to do a lot of that starting later this week. All right. So that's going to wrap up the NFL segment. Now we're going to go into our high five 60-second segment, where we are going to go around the table and get everybody's 60-second picks of the week. And I get to decide here which way to go. By the way, I'm also going to hold off when I'm done with each one of you. I'll go ahead and release Mark's complimentary play of the week. So it's in college football. So he's got a college football complimentary play of the week. And I did ask him for a trend. He gave me the pick, which I was surprised about. He gave me one pick, and I wasn't surprised because I know there's some trends that would go that way. Then he gave me the next pick. He goes, "Nah, scratch that. I'm going to give you this one." And I'm like, "Really? Okay. Give me a trend. I want to know why you're picking that team," but I haven't heard back from him. All right. So I'm going to go ahead and go around the horn here, picking one of you guys each for 60 seconds, and I'm going to start with Andy. So, Andy, are you ready to go?
I am.
Let me go ahead and set this up here for your 60 seconds. So you ready?
Ready.
There you go.
Okay. I'm going to go with the Mountain West Championship game between Boise and UNLV, with Boise hosting this game in the championship on Friday night. And when I first looked at the line, which was 3.5 or 4, it seemed really short for me, given the fact that Boise has all this edge and experience and they are playing at home. They beat them here in Vegas last year in the championship game, 44-20. It was mostly a non-competitive game, and ended up being the losses that they ended up ending with, three straight losses. They had lost their game previously and then lost their bowl game in that wild one against Kansas. When I look here, Boise has such a strong home field advantage. The stats do support this being a competitive game. But I think with the pressure being on Boise to continue to make it into the championship game, I think this line is a little bit too short. I've got Boise winning this game something like 34-24.
Perfect. 58 seconds, Andy. Excellent job. And, yeah, we didn't talk about that game, but I agree. I was a little bit surprised that the line was where it was. As good as this quarterback has played for UNLV, coming in from a starter who backed out, his numbers have actually looked better because he's an athlete. He can run. He gives him that little bit of a wrinkle. But let's also keep in mind that he's an FCS quarterback playing in a Mountain West Conference championship game against like one of the best Group of Five defenses in college football. So
they put pressure on the quarterback.
Absolutely. So I like Boise State as well.
And you wonder how the new quarterback will feel on that colored field. That takes some time getting used to.
All right. Anybody else, by the way, before I move on to my second analyst for Boise State UNLV pick? No? Nobody's got anything? All right. Next up. Let's go with Victor. Victor, are you ready?
Yes, I am. Go ahead. Count me down or whatever you got to do.
Here you go, Victor. Go ahead and start.
Okay, we'll do, and we'll do this free play courtesy of our boy Tuco. And it's a tough one. Week 14 of the NFL is a tough one when it comes to Tuco's favorite thing, which is first half overs, because three of his favorite teams are all off with their bye week this week, first half over teams. Denver, Baltimore, Washington. And his fourth favorite over team, Carolina, plays the league's best first half under team in Philadelphia. So we got to lay off. It's a week of scrounging, if you will. But we're going to go with what worked for Tuco last week, and that's a team total, and that's the Buffalo Bills to score over 26.5 points in their road game against the Rams. And we won't have to deal with any snow like we did last week when we still cashed a winner. Sharp bettors know what they're getting, definitely, guys. One of three teams that's averaging more than 29 of the season, that's Buffalo. Not only that, they've scored 30 or more points in each of their last six games. That's the Buffalo Bills. Indoor games, they've averaged 31 or more points per game in their last five versus six indoor games, and also 6-1 last seven against NFC opponents. Buffalo Bills over 26.5.
All right, way over, Victor, but I know a spot and where I can edit.
That's right, it's going way over, I know.
Victor, I thought you were going to see Tuco's favorite are the treats you give him after he hits each game.
Yeah, right. Either that or the kick I give him when he loses and he sleeps out on the patio.
All right. Oh, I like Buffalo to win in cover.
This is the animal abuse hotline.
Right. Well, I think we love our canines, don't we, Jim? Yes, we do.
Yes, we do.
I think Jim said it earlier. This could be a flat spot for Buffalo considering where they have this week and next week. So I might actually take a look at the Rams plus the points in this game, figuring that, you know, we've seen Buffalo a couple of times rally to get some late field goals to win games and things like that. This could be one of those games where, it's a 24-23 type game and Buffalo – does what Buffalo does and goes down and gets that game-winning field goal. So I could see the Rams, because this is a desperation game for the Rams more as much as
definitely
it is.
Desperation.
Yes, it is. Yeah. Yes, it is. And I think Greg is in agreement with me. I think Buffalo's just too good to look ahead.
Yeah, I actually think that if they are in a tough game, that would be the only thing that would stop them. But Philadelphia went in there, no problem. Miami went in there, no problem. And I think Buffalo's got to – I know they're respectful enough to know what kind of opponent they have on their hands.
Well, part of the thing is also the Rams are not as good a defensive team as they've been in past years. The numbers show that.
Oh, yeah. Nah. Yeah. Rams look like they're one of those teams this year that can beat the bad ones, but when they have to step up a competition, they just don't have it. All right, next up, let's go with Mr. Feist. Jimmy boy, are you ready, Jimmy boy?
I'm ready, but, you know, I've never once stayed under the number here, you know, so I'm in trouble.
Oh, yes, you have. Yes, you have. All right, here you go, Jim.
I'm going to take Carolina plus the 13 points, and it's not because I believe Carolina is necessarily in the same market as Philadelphia, because I'm going to give you a second play when I go to talk about Philadelphia. But I believe that they're playing better. The quarterback's playing better. They're not tanking, not like the Giants. They're not tanking. And Philadelphia's coming off a couple monster games, very, very big games ahead of them as well. They are right now in the NFC. I think they are the best team only because the Lions are injured so much on the defensive side of the ball, and their right tackle is also hurt, which is going to hurt their running game. I also feel that there's a bet out there that Philadelphia should get the win the NFC and end up having the championship game in their park.
Well, you went under there, even though you gave two picks.
Unbelievable. I did it.
So, as far as that game, that's interesting, because I was looking at it myself, Jim. I was like, yeah, you know what? Carolina may not be a bad pick, not only for the sandwich part, but if you take a look at it, they've covered four straight. They covered Kansas City and Tampa Bay. We talked about that. And they've also covered 10 straight as dogs of five or more when they take on an opponent off an upset win. And they're 1-0 in that spot this year. So
Wow.
The only concern that I would point out there, This is Carolina's.
I think there are a lot of concerns, actually.
Yeah, but no, but this is Carolina's first road game since October 27th. More than a month.
Sure. Absolutely.
Not playing on the road.
Well, we'll find out. You know, hot. We'll find out if now this is their next step. Playing a you know a really good team on the road.
At least I know I'm ahead when the gun goes off in the beginning. That's all I know.
All right. Well, we all know who this is. Last one up. Tony, are you ready?
I better be if I'm batting cleanup.
Yes.
I've had all this time. But I'll tell you what, you can count me down. We're going back to Bills Rams because I have a different pick from Victor.
Oh, okay.
In the same realm.
Okay. Well, here you go. Tony, you're up.
All right. Buffalo hits the road. Again, it's a cross-country trip, but I don't think that's going to matter, especially since everybody knows that SoFi doesn't really offer the home team advantages. And the Rams come off being shut out in the first half of games. So they scored 21 to beat the Saints. Buffalo has scored 30 or more in 6 straight games and 9 of their 10 wins. So you got McVay and Stafford knowing they have to show out. I expect an aggressive game plan because the Rams really need this game, as we've talked about. So the Rams have only scored 30 points all season one time. And maybe they don't do that here, but I think they're aggressive enough to carry their weight in a full game over 49.5 points.
Very good. Under the number here, under the 60. That works out well, Tony. So that's our high five segment of the week. And we still have a few more things to wrap up with. And as we take a look at some of our viewer comments, matter of fact, don't forget about the Coffee Club daily email that is available. We have links in the description. You can get all this awesome, fun information when you wake up in the morning. You got your cup of coffee, you put your email together. Boom, there it is. And you can read some really cool stats, trends, historical stuff. Matter of fact, we even have the opportunity to chat with Mark Lawrence. And one of our readers, Andrew from Columbia, Missouri, wonders, how do you think Sam Darnold will take the signing of Daniel Jones? Will there be a rift or will they provide a strong 1-2 punch? And Mark says it was reported that immediately after the Vikings agreed to terms on a deal with Jones, fans started speculating about Darnold's future in Minnesota. He's been having a career year, et cetera, et cetera. Signing DJ today, very happy to be teammates with him, says Darnold. Spent some time with him in the past. Great guy, blah, 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 blah. At the end, it sounds like to me they'll get along like peanut butter and jelly, says Mark. I don't know about you guys, but I don't see Sam Darnold coming back. I think Daniel Jones is going to be sort of like the backup guy to McCaffrey. That's why he signed. Hopefully they'll have some time now to work with them to find out before the draft and before free agency if they need to bring in someone else. They drafted McCaffrey to be the long-term starter. They're just not going to dish out $40 million or more to Sam Darnold, which is, again, what we talked about before, guys. That's what it's going to take. You're going to have to spend big bucks now to sign Sam Darnold on a multi-year deal.
Yeah, he's having a good enough season where he deserves a shot at A, getting the bag,
yes,
but B, getting the starting gig somewhere else. Yeah, he deserves that.
Anybody have a destination that you think might fit perfectly for Sam Darnold?
Tennessee, maybe? What do you think?
How about Vegas?
Levis is starting to show some signs of development.
You're TD, absolutely right
his
on that.
TD, you take a look at his TD to interception ratio, let's say in his first 4 or 5 games compared to his last 4 or 5 games. It switched around nicely. And once again, you got a new coach there that is taking some time to get used to the personnel and the schemes and the chemistry between the players, et cetera. So I think Tennessee's probably – well, I think the rest of the season will decide on what Tennessee does. I do like Tennessee this week in their game against Jacksonville. It's just it's a winnable game and another chance for Levis to gain some confidence and comfort that he seems to have picked up over the last month. But what about Cleveland?
That's what I was going to say. Given the injury that Watson's going to try to come back from, I don't think he plays again there. If they move on from Winston, maybe they can ruin another quarterback and ruin Darnold again.
Well, I tell you what, the quarterback that comes into Cleveland next year will be in a much better situation because they'll have Chubb healthy again. Not like he is this year. We all know he'll be better next year for it. The offensive line will be healthier. So that quarterback that comes in to start week one next year is going to be in a much better situation.
And Garrett has a lot of football left in him on defense.
Yes. What do you think about the head coach? Do you think they're going to get rid of the head coach?
No, no. They'd be stupid. No. Do you know how many teams would snatch up Stefanski if the Browns shit can?
I think he should stay and the owner should go.
Agreed. Yeah, well, worst ownership in the NFL, Jim. Absolutely. Jimmy Haslam has botched this team from the get-go. God.
The signing of Watson was probably the worst move in the NFL in about 35 years. The most previous one that I can think of was that Herschel Walker trade for Dallas.
Right. They're saying it's not only a worst football move, but it's one of the worst economic moves of the last 20 years is the money that they wasted on that guy.
Speaking of the Minnesota Vikings and Herschel Walker, you mentioned Minnesota in a teaser, Jim. So I know one of our coffee club readers, actually this is a YouTube viewer, Randy Paul 6281. He's the one that really likes the teasers. So do you have a teaser? Does anybody else have a teaser? Jim, you can add one. Does anybody else have a teaser to go along with Minnesota this week?
How about
Miami?
Miami would.
That's a good one.
What is that price? Yeah, that would take it down to pick them. Yeah, that's a great play.
There you go.
That's a great play.
Minnesota Miami teaser. I'm going to mark that down.
How about Pittsburgh?
Pittsburgh's also a good one.
I also think the Seahawks are a good teaser. Taking the Seahawks from +2.5 to +8.5.
I would bump the Rams up. I don't think they lay an egg this weekend.
Who's that?
The Rams.
The Rams.
Sounds like we have a lot of good teasers.
Yeah. Those are some gambles, though, those last two. What were they? The Rams and what'd you say, Victor?
The Seahawks from 2.5 to 8.5.
All right.
That's the classic.
How about Tampa Bay against the Raiders?
That's also a good one.
I'm a little leery with Mayfield. How much does the 17 really
teaser pay?
I think it was like 6 to 1 or something.
Well, let's say if you go with Minnesota, Miami, Pittsburgh, and Tampa, basically all of those teams would turn into just pick-ems where all they have to do is win. So what is that? What's a four-team teaser?
Maybe what?
Do we know?
Three to two?
I don't know what the prices are for 4 and 5 and 6 and 7. I don't know.
I don't bet them.
Yeah. All right. Well,
I'm guessing it's probably between 3 and 2 and 5 to 2, I'm guessing.
All right. So there you go. And then if you want to add a 6-1 with the Rams in Seattle from Tony and Victor, there you go. I'll jot that down.
Let me ask you, which side of the teaser would you play in the Monday night game between reliable Cincinnati and the Cowboys, who are coming off 2 wins and are facing, again, a defense that they may have some success against, and the line right now is 5.5 or 6?
Bengals all day long, because I don't think CeeDee Lamb plays, and then you're basically down to nothing, at least.
But they still have 11 guys on offense to go against that Cincinnati defense.
Yeah, no, that's true. But,
if CeeDee doesn't play, Tony's right.
Victor, what are you liking the total in that game?
It's too high for me right now, definitely. This is the kind of line you'd expect if Dak Prescott were the quarterback for the Cowboys, right? 49, 50 points.
Wow.
So it's too high for me.
Wow. But Dallas has gotten healthier on defense. Bland is back. Parsons is back.
I will not bring it. Now, guys.
35 every game.
Monday night games. This is the best year for overs in Monday night games in about 15 seasons now. 12 overs, only 4 unders. Monday night games this year, 51.6 combined points per game. So I don't blame you for thinking that it's going to be a high-scoring game. I still can't bring myself to play the over in any Monday night game in which the road team is favored. The under numbers historically are just too much to look at. So I'm laying off the total.
So the road team being favored is mostly an under?
Yes, on Monday Night Football.
Really?
Yes.
There you go.
That line is very strange given the performance of the Bengals relative to the talent that they have. But you can say the same thing about Dallas. When would you have expected, if coming into the season, I don't know what the numbers are, you would have expected Dallas to probably be a favorite in this game, maybe of up to a field goal, given their domination at home last year. And that Cincinnati, remember, was not a playoff team last year, although they did have some injuries. So this is one of the more unusual lines compared to what history would suggest. And I'm really surprised that given how Cincinnati has been able to fade, that even against the Dallas team, notwithstanding that they've won 2 in a row, that they are that high of a favorite on the road.
What about Dallas's home teams? What are the scores in the 5 home games that they've played this year?
Well, they blew out. They got blown out in the first two games. Well, they got blown out by New Orleans.
I got them right in front of me because I was looking at it.
0-4, straight up and against the spread as a home dog this year. And I only got the last three by 115-25.
They've lost 44-19. That game was over by halftime. They lost to the Ravens 28-25, but they were down a ton.
That was, I think, a 28-6 game, entering the fourth quarter.
Baltimore almost blew that game. That's the big deal there.
Well, they waited the next week against the Raiders to do that.
47-9 to Detroit, 34-6 to the Eagles, 34-10 to the Texans, and finally won last on Thanksgiving against the Giants. So they've just been dreadful at home. You can't trust them at home.
The Giants aren't even an FBS team. They're an FCS team this year.
Yeah. So I think the Bengals are a solid play with no CD.
Yeah.
So we've got our maybe we'll even start this as a new I don't know if you'll call it a tip, our tip of the week. Mm-hmm. So our total tip of the week from Victor, the road team on Monday Night Football that's favored, go with the under. So that's a historical.
What did you say those numbers were? Victor, what did you say those numbers were going back?
Talk about something. Give me 10 seconds.
Don't give us 57%. I want to hear 70% or higher.
Usually he has some strong stuff. Yes. That's for sure.
And I've got, in the meantime, Mark's complimentary play of the week. So I don't think you guys are going to believe it.
I'm not going to guess the play. I'm going to guess it might be in either the Western Kentucky Jacksonville State game or the Marshall UL Lafayette game.
Wow. Okay.
I got the numbers,
like,
guys.
Go ahead. What is it?
Road favorites on Monday Night Football. Now, we may be seeing a situation here in which the worm is starting to turn. But dating back to the 21 season, so three full years with the new rules in the NFL, the extra game added, Monday Night games in which the home team is favored have gone 6 overs, 24 unders.
You mean the road team is favored?
Road team is favored, sorry. Yep. 6 overs, 24 unders. That's 75% against the spread. However, guys, heading into the season, the numbers were 2-23. This year, in this season alone, when the road team is favored, there's been 4 overs and 1 under. That's why I say you might have a situation now in which things
stay
are
away.
Coming. Everything's coming back down to the mean.
Yeah.
So again, this year it's gone 4-1. Actually,
well, this has also been a better year than the last few as far as overs in general. I think there's about a 10 or 11 game edge for overs this year. I've got three pushes marked in. So last year was a very strong under year overall.
Absolutely. 101-90 I got right now for the year. And I have 4 ties, 101 overs, 90 unders on the season. 45.6 is your average. That's about a point in a game to 2 points higher than last year, in which NFL games averaged 43.8.
And as far as those other games, those championship games, you got Army-Tulane. Tulane, I believe, is a 4-point favorite. You mentioned the other games.
And that one, by the way, is being played up at Mikey Stadium at Army.
At West Point.
Yeah.
Cold weather.
That's at West Point. Yeah. It'll be a 22-degree night at West Point on Friday night. You have the Jacksonville Alabama game. Jacksonville State's a 4-point favorite of Western. You have Miami of Ohio, a 2.5-point favorite of Ohio in the Dome. And you mentioned Marshall. They're a 4-point dog at Lafayette, Louisiana.
I think I saw that line had gone up to at least 5.5. I don't know. It is a home game for them, and they've been very well. And they've Marshall has not been as strong as they have been this year. This is an unusual year for Marshall.
So, out of those group of five championship games, does anybody have like a favorite pick?
I like Army plus the points.
Okay.
Tulane coming off of that loss, but maybe they were just playing out there. But Army's tough to defend, and they've got a little bit more of a passing game this year than they've had in past years.
Yeah, Tulane had some really untimely turnovers last week. That's what really killed them against Memphis. They were clearly a better team than Army, but it's tough to go to Army, night game, all that. I do wonder, though, this is the first time, keep this in mind, this is the first time Army, everybody could say what they want about, Army, when you have to play Navy,
sometimes
it's a distraction, sometimes it's not. But if you look at it, check this out. Army's 3-0 straight up and against the spread the last 3 years before they play Navy. So you go, yeah, wow. But
keep in mind, they also usually have 2 and sometimes 3 weeks off.
That's my point. That's a completely, don't worry about that, because yeah, they have never had to play Navy with a 1 week deal, especially yeah, playing a game where they're playing for a championship. So yeah, that doesn't mean Army's not going to win in cover. It just means, yeah, don't worry about that. Don't look at it.
By the way, the thing that you have to wonder about Tulane's mindset, because there was a real chance that the winner of if Tulane won last week and they would beat Army and Boise, yeah, State falls to UNLV, Tulane would be that group of five team. Now it's almost certain, I would think, that the winner between Boise and UNLV gets that spot.
Gets that spot. Yeah.
It's guaranteed. Yes.
Yeah.
The winner's
in. Doubt about that.
And but I would say that Tulane, you know, look, the whole motto is usually when the coach sits you down at the beginning of the season,
win the conference.
Right, what are our goals? Yeah. Win the conference championship. Do this, do that. So it's still got to be about the conference, yeah, championship. I think they'll be okay as far as that's concerned. Tony, do you have one of these Group of Five conference deals that you like the most?
I lean to Tulane, but not too enthused about it. I'm really concerned about Summerall and where his, yeah, mind is getting all these offers. You know he's getting them. But I think Jack State pulls off their win. And it's hilarious to see Rich Rodriguez getting sniffs for major gigs again. And
you know he's going.
Last week. They also just played last week, that game that went down to the wire.
Right.
And Jacksonville State, if I recall correctly, started 0-3 this season.
You asked me if I wanted anybody in particular. No, at UCF, not yet. But I would not want Rich Rod.
Yeah. I mean, I guess the thing with Rich Rod, though, is if I'm going to hire him, I want to know first and foremost, who's your defensive coordinator?
And how many years do you have left?
Yeah, you have, if I know who your defensive coordinator, if I trust that guy, all right, I'll hire you. But
it could also be two years of winning and 4 years of probation coming up.
Well, now they have lax rules on that. So
yeah, yeah, that's true with the NIL.
Mark's complimentary play, Penn State.
Ooh.
So he's going with Penn. And again, I'm surprised because the numbers, the trends, which Mark is all about, to me, they all say take Oregon. So maybe he's got some numbers that you'll find out in the newsletter that I'm not privy to yet.
I'm wondering if the trends he may have would apply to conference championship games overall as opposed to Penn State or Oregon specifically. And so maybe he might have something, let's say, in Big Ten championship games that the underdog may have, covered without winning in short point spreads over the years, which would certainly point to Penn State.
No, that's not it, because the favorites covered and won each of the last three Big Ten championships.
Yeah. So
that'll be an interesting read when we get the newsletter.
Yeah, we'll be looking out for it. We'll find out why Mark is going with the complimentary play of Penn State. We'll find out definitely next week, especially if he wins and Penn State beats Oregon or covers. That's all you have to do. But hopefully we'll see Mark again next week. I think things will even be a lot easier on his workload because we only have a certain amount of games. And the following week, it's Army and Navy. So
there is one bowl game on the Army-Navy day, the Camellia Bowl between, I think it's South Alabama and Western Kentucky kicking things off, Lord. I believe.
South Alabama and Western Kentucky.
South Alabama gave South Alabama or South Florida.
Where is that South game? Alabama. Is that the game in the Bahamas?
It's in Montgomery.
No, it's in Montgomery, Alabama. Don't slight an opportunity to make money, even though you have to check who's opted out of the game. South Florida is going to Hawaii.
It can't be Western Kentucky, right? Because they're playing.
Yeah, no, I'm sorry, Western Michigan.
Western Michigan.
Good little MAC team.
Even better. Even more marketable. All right, guys. So that's going to wrap it up. Appreciate it as always. Great job. A lot of fun. Can't wait till next week when we get an opportunity to talk about the real final 12-team college football playoffs. It's here. It'll be here when we – by the way, don't forget, check out 12 o'clock, I believe. It's probably when it'll be available because that's the way it's been the last few years. check it out, because that's when they'll want to market it, just before NFL kickoff on Sunday. So look for it, and then we'll talk all about it next week. And again, hopefully we'll see Mark back next week as well.
And bowl lines will be out Sunday afternoon, Monday morning.
Bowl lines!
There you go.
Playoff lines. That's what we're interested in. Playoff lines.
Good luck this weekend, by the way, guys.
Yeah, there are two other bowl games that have been announced. On the 17th, the Tuesday after the Army-Navy game, Memphis and West Virginia. And on the Christmas Eve, the 24th, South Florida and San Jose. Those bowl games have already shown up in print.
Joy. Anyway, on that note,
I don't know if the West Virginia, I don't know if Clark is going to be coaching West Virginia in that game after being fired earlier in the week.
No, he's not. He's already wished him luck.
Wow. Okay. We're going to talk about coaching hires as well next week. So we're out of here, and we'll see everybody once again next week on Playbook ATS.